Philippine shares so far outperforming peers, up for all 2 weeks of January so far, holding on to 6,600. Can we keep the momentum going though? Or would profit taking take us down back below 65? For more on the markets, we want to bring in Gabriel Aguila, head of research at UniCapital Securities. Hi, Gabriel. Thank you so much for joining us.
Hi, morning. Nice to be here.
All right. You think stocks have already run too much, too far, too soon in the first 2 weeks of the year? I mean, what is in this price?
I think the stocks right now, its prices, it's gone a little bit higher than we expected it to be from last year. But then again, we did see positive developments, especially in the rate cuts view. So I think at this point, we're doing 6,600 right now. It's quite sustainable and we think it's warranted. Index numbers or valuations have been quite discounted. As we rolled over, we're now looking at around still 10.6, 10.8 times. And it's still quite attractive for us. We think that right now, corrections or profit taking is more of a healthy correction, but overall market sentiments for us is moving upwards and it's pointing upwards.
All right, because everybody I talk to, seeing how much we've run up in the last 2 weeks, are asking, what are the chances that 2024 is going to be 2023 all over again? We were outperforming last year this time, and then we finished somewhere in the last. You don't think so?
Right.
You think this year is going to be different?
Yeah. Last year, when we entered the first 3 months, what we were still uncertain of was how far inflation would go and how high interest rates would go. And compared to last year, we think the first quarter of last year already has peaked it. And we've seen that over the past one quarter, interest rates have started to plateau at its peak already. So going into 2024, the expectation is that rate cuts will happen later towards this year. Inflation is expected to continue to ease. So the footing of where we start from is very different. Also compared to last year, I think the current run-up isn't as strong as last year. We can still see investors really thinking about their moves getting into the market.
All right. Gabriel, I just wanted to bring in the opening numbers. We're about 2 minutes into trade for the day. The PSEI is up 0.1%, 7 points. We're at 66.50. Most sectors are in positive territory except for two. Services down by 0.02%, property by 0.07%. I wanted to bring in, let's take a look at the calendar for this week, the week ahead. If you could just flash it, there you have it. Is there anything that you see moving the needle this week for us? I mean, you've got cash remittances for the Philippines due later in the day. Eventually, we're looking at China GDP and a slew of other data points from Beijing coming out on Wednesday. U.S. retail sales, U.K. inflation also out on Wednesday. The beige book from the Fed on Thursday. U.S. building permits, Japan inflation due on Friday. Is there anything that excites you that you see becoming a major catalyst for the next 5 days?
Well, the most optimism I can see that we can lend to the Philippine market here is definitely our cash remittances. We'll see if we're on track to meet the 2023 target of 3%, which I believe was last at 2.7% around October. And that would also benefit our peso and the view on the peso. So that should keep the market buoyant. With regards to international news, spillovers are, we believe, are right now coming from positivity in the U.S. markets. So we're going back to the point where we're moving in step with the global sentiments back again now that the overall macro sentiments have started to improve.
All right. All right. Going back to the local market, is there a shifting sector sentiment that you're seeing for this year? Maybe a rotation risk happening just beneath the surface?
Definitely for us, if we're not to look at risks first, we look at positives. Property, definitely positive, because we're seeing interest rate, the prospect of interest rates go down. On the other side, telco is another one that may have a reversal this year. Lower interest expense, lower capex cost of funds for its capex, easing inflation should be positive for it. Where we still see some risk would be in the power sector, given that some companies really have to raise funds to pursue their target pipelines before the rate cuts happen end of the year. So they really can't sit around and wait for rate cuts. That's where we see a higher interest rate expense for them that will be carried over into 2025, 2026, depending on the terms that they're able to secure for those loans.
Let's not hide these power companies. Which power companies are looking at taking out big loans? Companies that you think do not have the luxury of waiting for these rates to go down before borrowing money just to fulfill their pipeline.
Yes, I wouldn't say it as a negative because at the end of the day, pipeline, pursuing the pipeline is very important and over the long term will be very accretive for the company. But if we're to look at two companies right now that I think are looking to raise a good amount of funds to be able to pursue their pipeline, it would definitely be ASEN, AC Energy, and Alternergy or Alter.
All right, two companies. You mentioned earlier telcos. Big news last week, Dito, the two Dennis Uy companies, one from Pampanga, one from Davao. Dito, CME and Converge ICT partnering up for enhanced fiber connection and network reliability. Do you see something more than the headline news? Could it be, you know, Pampanga's Dennis Uy's, you know, one foot in the door for mobile network services instead of just sticking to fiber?
Yes, definitely. For me now, one key difference is I'm referring to them collectively as the OIS. So the OIS putting it together have actually, you know, started to give them an idea that there's a tel inside them or a globe, because now you're doing both fiber and telco already at the same time. On a horizons perspective, this should help their capex, both for both companies, their capex budget and the efficiencies that they get from that, given that they're now going to work in step to achieving pretty much the same goal of expanding their network. What we do see there is maybe some execution risk as we move forward, compared to your Globe and Tel. These are two different companies that will be working together, but otherwise it's the partnership does bode well in being two entities that can compete in the scene of our telco giants.
All right. Over the weekend, also big news, U.S. regulators approving Bitcoin ETFs. Does this change your strategy in any way?
When we look at Bitcoin, definitely some liquidity will go into there, especially because the volatility does give some high margins. But focusing on the equity space, I think right now there's a lot of attractive, less risk assets that we could look at into accumulating. So we think that it would be largely dependent on the type of investor. And coming from a fundamental perspective or a recommendation for investors, a high risk, high volatile asset would be best kept the smallest proportion of your portfolio.
All right. Going now to consumer stories, Jollibee. Tony Tan Kakyang's Jollibee has just opened its 100th store in North America. You know, for the longest time, we've been saying Jollibee is so expensive. Growth may be, you know, hitting satiation point locally. What are your thoughts on Jollibee now, given where the price is, plus how much more room there is for growth, considering they're looking outside for growth already?
Yes, we've been looking at this avenue since around the start of 2023, end of 2022. We know that Jollibee has wanted to expand its U.S. presence or North American presence, and that they plan to do that not by doing company-owned stores, but by franchising, which did allow them to hit their 100th store count quite quickly rather than if they had to do their own company-owned store setup. So for that, if we're looking at the 100th store right now, we still think that there's space in the North America to market going forward. They do want to shift the same strategy for their other regions, which overall does bode well for its growth prospects. It is less cost for Jollibee, and it is a faster prospect for expansion.
And you think the price is still affordable?
Right now, there's been a lot of positivity in it. Maybe a little bit of a correction may be warranted to get a little bit more accumulation. Moving forward, we will still expect some healthy corrections or some market weakness and profit taking. But other than that, sentiments, again, are for us pointing upwards.
All right. And from Jollibee to cement, Ramon Del Rosario's Phil Cement of FINMA is set to take over operations of Petra Plant in Zamboanga del Norte. We know that this is a plant that's being run by Henry Big Boy C. Cement companies, good play for 2024?
Cement companies right now will still have a little bit of headwinds in terms of weakness in our US dollar rate, exchange rate compared to a few years ago. But otherwise, the government ramping up its prospects for PPEs and for infrastructure, that bodes well for cement. Plus, we're also likely to see a resurgence of construction once interest rates and the costs to build and the funding to secure it start to go down.
All right. And Nomura is seeing BSP rate cuts starting August of this year. And you just mentioned this, if we could share, you know, how two power companies are at risk of, you know, accumulating more debt even before the rate cuts actually happen. We have this from ASEN. Just an update on corporate transactions. They've issued corporate guarantee and support of ASEN Cayman for a total of $320 million loan that the unit is taking out. That's $140 million from PNB and $180 million from RCBC. A loan obtained by ASEN Cayman will be used to redeem the redeemable preferred shares held by AC Energy Finance International, and the proceeds will in turn be used to redeem its maturing green bonds. Gabriel, I think we're ready for your blind item. Talk to us about the stock that you're monitoring closely and that you like. Don't tell us. Just describe what you have for us today.
Okay, so what I have for the day is in the stock in the retail space. 9 months performance did show revenue growth in 2023, albeit narrower a bit the margins, but that was driven by macro headwinds in the form of rising operating costs. Expectations for easing inflation, lower interest rates, and stabilizing macro for this year on the cost sides most especially bodes well for the prospect this 2024. Likewise, its store openings in full year 2023 looks like it may have hit target by the fourth quarter of 2023. Stock has been gone quite unnoticed in the past, especially from last year as retail started to slow down. But for us now, fundamentally shows a target price of 30.50 pesos per share. I think for the last traded price, it has an upside of around 16%.
16% over what time period?
Over a 12-month forward period.
Okay, 12-month period. All right, on that note, we're just going to have to guess which stock this is. Gabriel, thank you so much for joining us this Monday morning. Have a great and profitable week ahead.
All right, thank you.